Greetings, brother. I understand the proof you offer and would like to discuss it. When Abraham offered his only son, that must have been Ishmael. Abraham sired two sons, and there was only one time Abraham had only one son. Therefore, since Abraham only had one son when Ishmael was his only son, he must have offered Ishmael. As I said, I understand the logic of your argument, based on your definition and emphasis on only son. To be thorough, we need to respect the message that Prophet Moses revealed. So let us first read from Genesis. Genesis 17:19. And God said, Sarah, thy wife, shall bear thee a son indeed, and thou shalt call his name Isaac, and I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant, and with his seed after him. Notice, brother, this is God talking. And God calls Sarah his wife. God says the name to give the boy. Call his name Isaac. And then God makes his promise. And I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant. With him, meaning the boy named Isaac I just foretold. So that is one statement from God, brother. And if we are good, honest students, we read the context. If we respect the message of God, we read the context. The very next verse is the only one Islam allows you to read, brother. Genesis 17:20, as for Ishmael, I have heard you. Behold, I have blessed him and will make him fruitful and multiply him greatly. He shall father 12 princes, and I will make him into a great nation. As for Ishmael, I have heard you. There is no doubt that Ishmael was a living, breathing human being, brother. And there is no doubt that Abraham loved Ishmael. But to understand the events, you must read, Ikra, the whole context, brother. Genesis 17:15. And God said to Abraham, as for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall become nations. Kings of people shall come from her. Notice, brother, Sarah is the focus of God's promise here. I will give you a son by her. I, God, will give you, Abraham, a son by her, by Sarah, your wife, Sarah. Imagine the God who made heaven and earth promising to give an old man with a barren old wife a son. This is God promising a miracle, brother. And even for Abraham, it was a hard thing to believe in completely. Then Abraham fell on his face and laughed and said to himself, shall a child be born to a man who is 100 years old? Shall Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child? Genesis 17:18. So Abraham said to God, may Ishmael live under your special blessing? And even as I'm studying this, brother, and preparing this video, something occurs to me. Already, Abraham has had sex with Hagar and has sired Ishmael. Ishmael is already a living, breathing boy who God can surely see. Do you understand what I am saying, brother? Ishmael has already been born. When God speaks of giving Abraham a son by Sarah, his wife, Abraham and Hagar have already done the deed, done the nasty. So Sarah giving Hagar to Abraham as a tilth to plow has happened at least a year or more before this. And yet God, now again appearing to Abraham, looks right past Ishmael. God again repeats his promise of a son through Sarah, of a miraculous son through Sarah. But Abraham, a loving father with one son at that time, desires that Ishmael not be overlooked. And Abraham said to God, oh, that Ishmael might live before you. I don't think Abraham ignored or hated Ishmael. In fact, God is not unsympathetic to Abraham's father's heart. Genesis 17:19, God said, no. Let's just stop right there, brother. Does it matter to you what God says? Take a moment and think before you answer, brother. Does it matter to you what God says? The answer God is looking for is yes. Yes, it matters that God says no. So when God says no, stop for a moment. Pause and understand what no means. No, but Sarah, your wife, shall bear you a son. Evidently God, the maker of heaven and earth, has an opinion about this topic, brother. And you shall call his name Isaac, and I will establish my covenant with him as an everlasting covenant, for his offspring after him. But God still listened to Abraham's plea for Ishmael. As for Ishmael, I have heard you. As for Ishmael, I have heard you, God says. God did not say, who? God did not say, Ishmael, who? But you must read all that God said, brother. As for Ishmael, I have heard you. Behold, I have blessed him, and will make him fruitful and multiply him greatly. He shall father 12 princes, and I will make him into a great nation. So that is certainly not God condemning Ishmael to obscurity. But again, you must ikra, read, because God is not through talking yet. But, that's one of those let-down words, brother. It says, something is coming which is going to disagree with or modify what I just said. But, I will establish my covenant with Isaac. I will bless Ishmael, but I will establish my covenant with Isaac. If you want to honor God, brother, you have to honor all that God said. When he had finished talking with him, God went up from Abraham. So, brother, since God made absolutely clear statements, you must try and respect God and understand what God meant. Especially when God later said, your only son, Isaac. And as I was preparing this, I had a thought. Maybe the original text said, take only your son, Isaac. As in, only take Isaac with you. Someone else along might not understand you putting Isaac on the altar. And sometimes different translations place a subtle difference on particular words, or they reorder the words to clarify an ambiguity. So I looked at a dozen translations and the Hebrew on Bible Hub. Your only son, your unique son, thine only son, thy only begotten son. Not one translator recombined the words to say, only thy son Isaac. Not one translator derived from the Hebrew this alternate meaning. And the Hebrew did not indicate an incorrect word order or association. It is worth noting the Hebrew word is yachid, for one or only. So there is no mistake that this implies something unique or significant, special about Isaac. But regarding Islam's argument that this one word must be the key that unravels the lie by Jews, that really is impossible to believe, brother. The text is consistent in every other way. However, I think Islam is motivated to try and argue away this very bitter pill to swallow. The text as a whole is completely damning to any claims by the seed of Ishmael. And I have one additional point for you to consider, brother. Islam's argument is simply not consistent with Islam's teaching, brother. God established blood sacrifice. This is the message of the prophets from Moses to Jesus. And for God to establish his covenant with Abraham through Isaac, God needed to ratify the new covenant with blood. This is the consistent and historically documented Judaism which the prophets revealed, brother. But Islam does not believe in blood sacrifice. So why is Islam in a hurry to believe Ishmael was the blood sacrifice Abraham was willing to offer? If Islam is correct for the changed Torah, why not deny the event altogether? Why doesn't Islam claim that Abraham neither bound Isaac, nor placed him on the altar, nor even journeyed with him? This exactly parallels the denial of the crucifixion of Jesus. And that is the unbreakable cord that ties history, brother. God made covenant with Isaac so that God could one day send his only son, Jesus. God needed Abraham to demonstrate that Abraham would sacrifice his son for the covenant, because one day God would sacrifice his only son for the covenant. The Old Testament and New Testament are in complete agreement on this, brother. So I understand Islam's claim and argument, brother. But knowing what God said and knowing why God said it convinces me Islam's claim and argument is completely wrong. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.